Hello and welcome to another episode of NSC FinWiz powered by CNBC TV18. We've touched down in the heart of the city of joy, Kolkata, and we're at the head office of one of India's oldest paint companies, Berger Paints.
Innovation, customer focus, contemporary and responsible product. The driving forces of Berger Paints reflect the very spirit of its founder, Louis Berger, who laid the foundations of the brand in 1760 in UK. With modest beginnings in India in 1923, currently Berger Paints India Limited is the second largest paint company in the country with a consistent track record of being the fastest growing conglomerate. Headquartered in Kolkata with 7 strategically located manufacturing units and over 85 sales offices, the company also has an international presence in 4 countries. With employee strength of over 2,500 and a countrywide distribution network of 15,000 plus dealers, Berger is acclaimed to be a game changer with a vibrant portfolio of paints and tailor-made customer services in every paint segment. Focusing on our theme for the series, NSC FinWiz visited Berger Paints Kolkata to gauge thoughts and notions of young professionals on investments and financial planning.
To invest around 70% of my saving into the investments, first of which is PPF, where I used to invest 1 lakh because it is a tax free, and further I get a deduction under ATC. So my both the purpose has been fulfilled here. After that, from the balance of the money, 50 to 60% I try to invest in secured fund, that is a bank FD or post office schemes, NSC, and with the balance 20% I used to invest in equity, into direct equity. Balance 10% I used to try invest it in gold.
I'm just started off with my career basically, so I'm not really invested in many sectors as such, but as of now the only investment that I have done is in recurring deposit and fixed deposit. But yes, I do have plans of investing in future, so I'm basically a risk averse person, so I would be I'm thinking of investing in sectors like PPF, maybe other LICs and all that. And also, as at present I feel real estate is also a good option of investment, so maybe a few years down the line I would like to invest in that sector.
Maybe I am averse to investment in stocks because I think that I am not an expert in that. Maybe if I get some good financial advice, I may invest in stocks also. I invest in mutual funds, but I don't invest directly in stocks.
I will discuss what is my pattern of investment for the all through this last year, and I will also discuss with him in what different ways or what are the major financial products, that means what are the more beneficial financial products in the market right now in the market, or what will be coming in the future market, so that we can get an assurance of getting the money back what we are investing today.
We are now joined by two very special experts. We have Mr. Harsh Rungta, who is an investment advisor and also the CEO at ApnaPaisa.com. And we also have Mr. Subhash Lakhotia, who is a tax and investment advisor and who is also called Tax Guru. Gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. Harsh, my first question to you is a very basic, simple question. For someone who is in their first job or maybe their second job and who has not started investing, what are the first 2 or 3 baby steps that they need to take to start a good investing plan?
So I think if you do that in 3 steps, okay, I think even before you think of investing, you should think of risk, right? I mean, just like you cannot be a good attacking batsman without being a good defense, having a great defense. Similarly, there is absolutely no point in having an investment strategy without first insuring yourself against risk.
Okay.
Whether the risk is of your dying too early, whether the risk is of you or somebody else close to you getting hospitalized, whether the risk is of getting disabled. Now, these are risks that precede investments. And very frequently, people feel that that's a waste of money. And I think this is one, within inverted commas, waste of money that people should definitely do. And then hope to God that money actually goes waste.
Okay.
That's the first thing. I think the second thing on investment, even before you get to what to invest in, is what to invest for. And so you ask anybody, what are you investing for? And I think everybody says, oh, I want to make money. Okay. And now, obviously, but you want to make money for what? So most people typically would have a need.
Right.
Typically, a child's education need. Typically, probably a need that they have a sufficient corpus for retirement. Maybe child's marriage, maybe to buy a house.
So setting goals, kind of
setting goals,
deciding what they need that money for.
So what that does is when you decide a destination,
yes,
okay, it gives a channel and an energy to your investment.
Okay.
And I think so the big key thing there is making sure that those goals are decided in a scientific manner.
Subhash, is it any time too early to set a goal, or I mean, is it never too late to set a goal?
Personally speaking, I would like to go a little slow. When the man gets a first job, he should not think and worry about big goals and dying and this and that thing. He, because till yesterday, this guy was in dependent only on the parents, pocket money, education, and that's it.
Yeah.
Today, fine morning, he gets a big job, and first thing he would like to is blow up. Yeah,
yes.
So much money is thing for the first time, he would like to blow up the money. But I personally feel that if on the first very day, first job, first day,
yeah,
if he were to think that I must have a blissful retirement life ultimately, then he should start saving from day one. Rather, the advantage is when he joins, gets the first job, opportunity of saving is great.
Yes.
Normally, he'll be unmarried. He has the option to save as much as he likes. And if you were to take a tip from me, that yes, guys, now save at least 30% right now.
Okay.
You'll have a bright future. No depression, no worry, no tension. And sometimes by chance the job goes away. Still, you have no worry, nothing to regret.
But there is this other word, other phrase that's very often used on channels as well as in newspapers and financial dailies, is the phrase asset allocation. What does that mean? Simplify it for our viewers.
So asset allocation is nothing complicated. I mean, it is just like when I have food,
yeah,
right? I can't, even though my favorite food may be a kheer, right?
Ah.
I can't just have kheer for food, right?
Okay.
I need vegetables, I need chapati, I need, if I'm a non-vegetarian, I might need a non-vegetarian dish. I need a mix. Similarly, I might have more of kheer, okay? But I need a mix. Similarly, when you invest, I need to invest in debt, I need to invest in equity, I need to invest probably in real estate if my this thing is big enough. Have a mix. I need to probably invest in gold. Have a mix. Do a little more on the one that you like.
Right.
Okay. But have a mix. So I think that really is what asset allocation is all about.
Subhashji, but how should one go about with this mix? So let's assume if they go with Harsh's idea and yours also, where you said save 30%. Now, this money that is saved, how do I decide how much to put in debt, how much to put in mutual funds, equity, gold, etc.?
But unfortunately, I am a strong vegetarian, not like my friend who talked about non-vegetarian. So I will go one track only. And for the younger people, just one, two, three items only, nothing more.
Okay.
And that is number one is PF, PPF.
Mm.
Number two, the stock market, NSE, investments, etc. or mutual funds. And number three, real estate. And that's it.
Okay.
Only three big items, and that will take care for next 10 years investment proposals, especially for those who are having first time job.
Harsh, now I want to talk to you about one very other important point that comes up very often. People say that I don't have money to save. There's so many expenses. When you're young, you're like, no, I have to. I've done these years of studying and I didn't have any money. Now I want to spend. Or otherwise, it's like, array, no, I don't. So what is like a minimum amount? How do they start? Because that first step is always the toughest.
I think the key is that 80-20 rule. Just take it out at source completely. Your income is only 80%. I mean, if you can make it 70%, great. Okay. The only exception to that is I don't think a lay person, okay, is really very well equipped to invest in shares directly. Okay. He tends to get swayed by emotions, tend to get swayed by tips, etc. A great way today is available, okay, whereby you can systematically, month after month, you can do a systematic investment plan. I mean, if you pick up the records,
yeah,
any 10-year SIP, okay, if you had done in the Nifty from 1995, take a 10-year SIP every month, month after month, irrespective whether the Nifty was up or down, if you invested from January 1995, okay, the minimum, absolutely minimum return that you would have got was 9%.
Okay.
Okay. The average, tax-free. Please remember, tax-free.
NSE FinWiz powered by CNBC TV 18 continues after this very short break. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. This is NSE FinWiz powered by CNBC TV 18. Today we are in Kolkata at Berger Paints. Subhashi, when we talk about mutual funds, now there are a lot of mutual funds which gets confusing for people, and then that's when they feel, oh, it's too confusing, let me just do something which is simple and easy. So when we talk mutual funds, there are exchange traded funds also which come under, then there is liquid mutual funds, there are debt mutual funds. So how does one
balance funds, fund of fund, and many more to come, isn't it?
Exactly.
I think especially for the younger generation joining service first time, small little income, let us talk small income, small money, they should go only for equity related mutual fund only, nothing else, nothing except that, and also invest in the stock market. But as my friend said, which stocks to buy, we don't know what to do. Very simple tip they can take, and that is new issues of government enterprises, if they are coming, and if the younger generation were to invest in that, they will have good time. Very interesting to find names of some of the companies where the stock price has become 92% higher just in 1 year. But if that type of return, if my friends are going to have, then the problem is they will leave their job in 5 years only. And I don't want to leave the job. So what I would suggest is a small little investment, if they make in the stock market, especially in the equities only, they will have a good time. Especially the theme for the equity is stay longer, earn higher.
Harsh, let's talk real estate, which is another where people are very inquisitive about real estate as an investment option. But the markets around the country have been going up and down, and there's a lot of, it's a risky bit, some people think. But some people are still, they want to invest in that. So how, what's your advice to them? Who, let's assume again, people who've just started investing. These are the first 5 years of they've been investing, and now they want to get into real estate.
Let's come to real estate as an investment, which is your other house, not the one that you are staying in. Now, your other house or a shop or whatever other real, it's not meant for normal investors. It's lumpy. It's not something everybody can afford. Your portfolio needs to be pretty large for you to be able to buy a second house. So I would urge you to look, returns on real estate, not bad, okay, generally tends to be positive, although people forget that we have seen two cycles of huge negative returns on real estate. So this notion, I meet clients all the time who say real estate is never goes down. Not true. It, even in India, we have had at least two cycles within the living memory, okay, where real estate has fallen, and has fallen dramatically.
Harsh, I want to talk to you about this new investment avenue that's come up in the last few years, is art. Art as a form of investment. Is it a good idea to get into that, or is it you need to do a lot of research to get into it? What do you say?
So again, let me quote a wise person, okay? Don't invest in something you don't understand. Okay, I don't understand art, so I can't actually even talk about art as an investment. I think for the lay person, I mean, art is an investment asset for somebody whose portfolio runs into double digit millions of dollars, not rupees. Right. Okay, uske liye, for him, a small portion in art is possible. Or art could be an investment for somebody who understands art. Yeah. So if you understand art, if you have a love for art, you can turn your hobby into it's risky, okay? It's a risky asset class, but if it's your hobby, you can look at it,
Subhashi, my final question to you is, we spoke to some of the employees here, we spoke to them earlier today, and some people have this question about chit funds. Are they a good investment option? How should one go about investing?
When I talk to friends of mine who are investing in the chit fund, their experience is it is cheat fund. I don't know, our friends only can say what is the reality. Okay. But from the tax angle, I can say no problem at all. No income, no taxation, nothing, chit funds.
Okay.
But personally speaking, I am not in favor of making investment in the chit fund. But one small piece of very, very small investment I can share, which can bring them lakhs of rupees. And that is very small, unprecedented small amount. 5, 10 or 100 rupees only, and it can, the value may be lakh or 2 lakh also. and that is investing in old rare books, old books. Nowadays the latest craze world over, and that's why I remember the days when in Kolkata College Street second-hand book market was there. There were lakhs of books were there. I don't know whether it's right now or not, but if there, some of our friends can buy old books, original copies. Cost price hardly 10-15 hundred rupees, but it can sell as high as 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 5 lakh, and maybe more.
So that's again like art. You got to, but you got to have that eye for that. You got to be a little passionate to know it, because I mean, some like you're saying, some.
No, but art I may not know whether it is upside down, downside. I don't know anything. But in the book, at least I can see the date of publication, original book. Okay. I can preserve it, keep it with me, and at least if not me, my children will sell it for lakhs of rupees.
I mean, okay. Some of you, when you were growing up, you would have read Amar Chitra Katha, yeah. Right? Now suddenly, Amar Chitra Katha has got value. I mean, for those of you who have the, after I read about this, I went back and checked. I have this huge collection of, I now have to find out the value.
Okay.
Right. But it can become value.
You're watching NSE FinWiz powered by CNBC TV 18. It's time for a very short break. And when we come back, the audience asks their questions of our experts. Welcome back. You're watching NSE FinWiz powered by CNBC TV 18. It's now time to go over to the audience to get their questions for our experts.
We have been a very risk-averse, society. So whatever your advices have been, I personally think that, say, we have been always been told by our parents that we should avoid investing in equities and invest in immovable properties. So do you think that's a right kind of an advice in or relevant in today's world, or we should have, say, a mix of both, and what is that we should do?
As I said, there needs to be balance, right? And I think we have a long tradition of investment in both land or now flats or shops, etc., and gold. I think we have a long tradition. But if you look at the data, you just look at the data over long periods. Don't look at it, I mean, so if you look at it 2005 to 2013, wow, it's done very well. So has gold and so has land, right? You stretch that a little, you stretch that to 10 years, 12 years, the return becomes very normal. Please exercise some amount of balance, 30%, 40%, if you're so inclined, maybe 50%. Please have other asset classes in the balance 50%, including debt. And including equity, everything is important, and gold as well.
As a part of our compensation structure and also as a part of our performance, on a yearly basis we get a certain performance pay. Now that pay is divided into two equal installments, and it's paid in the month of June and the month of December. My question is that, can you just advise us as regards to the sort of investment that we're supposed to do? I mean, to say, suppose if I'm getting 1 lakh of rupees, for example, what should be the ideal investment pattern in this 1 lakh of rupees? Because we get it, and somehow or the other, part of it is invested, the part is spent away, and it becomes a wastage at the end of the day. So my question is that if you can just advise
the
us.
The point is, as a salary executive, your theme should be, wherever I invest, any income derived therefrom should not be taxed in my hands. That's it. One single formula. Supposing you are coming in the 30% tax bracket, and now one lakh you have got for available for investment, and you were to invest it only in, say, bank FDR, getting 10,000 rupees yearly interest. Now if that 10,000 is added to your income, salary income, flat 30% goes away by way of income tax. So please plan in such a manner that this 3,000 rupees should be saved. But I am not aware whether to invest in stock market or mutual or gold or what to do. First thing should be, no income tax liability at all. And then once you keep this goal in mind, you've got various options like investment in shares of the companies, because I'll get dividend income, no tax on the dividend income. I'll invest a mutual fund, again, income from the mutual fund, no income tax at all. But if I'm not aware of these two things, third could be tax-free bonds. They will be acting like James Bond for you, because no income tax at all. 8.5% yield will be there, and no income tax at all.
I've learned to invest in a big pattern wise and in a systematic way only. And it should be a horizon of 10 years or 15 years and all. It should be long term only, not for short term. equities is not for short one and all. The better was it was for equities only, but I wanted more for commodity markets and all. It would have been better for us.
Basically, equity related discussions. Basically, what I thought of that, if even you have a decent income, even you can invest a lot more in equity related investments, and you can gain a more, whether you, there are traditional things like PPF or PF kind of things, so you can gain more in terms of your equity related investments. Basically,
I think the program was very enriching, especially who are just starting to invest. Firstly, it sets people thinking who have not yet investment, I mean, to think about investing, because most of us who have just started working do not really haven't thought about investing much or haven't put in too much of money into investments. And even if even if people have thought about investing, we are very confused as to what is the best approach. And definitely programs like this throw a lot of light on showing us the path as to what is the best approach should be.
Well, that brings us to the end of another interesting discussion at NSE FinWiz, powered by CNBC TV18's at Berger Paines. We'll be back next week with another set of young employees at another company. Until then, thank you for watching.